Pat Rigney will correct me. When did Brand Forum start? It must have been 12 years ago, 13 years. If 12 years ago we had been able to put together a panel of speakers, you know, senior managers from companies like Heineken, Cadbury's and Coca-Cola, we would have been thrilled. We would have had, I'm sure, had a very entertaining and very informative evening. But there would have been one difference. You would have gone home being informed and entertained, but you'd sit in your desk the next morning and say, I don't have the budget to be able to replicate any of that. And that's why tonight is so important and so exciting, because digital levels the playing pitch. Everything you're going to hear tonight, you can actually take a direct lesson from and implement yourself. So it's very important to listen to what these speakers have to say. As Niamh said, our first speaker is Julie Wells, marketing manager for Heineken Ireland. She's also worked for Marks & Spencer and has worked for Diageo. So she has, you know, experience in a lot of companies. Her presentation is titled Storytelling and the Move to Channel Neutral Briefs. So that's very important. Even the title itself is important. Storytelling, which is critical for digital, and the move to channel neutral briefs. Julie?
Hi, hope you can all hear me okay, so I'm all mic'd up and good to go. So as I said, I'm Julie, I'm with Heineken. I'm with Heineken Ireland. I'm the head of the Heineken brand for kind of just over a year and a couple of months. And we've actually undergone quite a transition over that period of time as we took some of the things that I'm going to talk about tonight into account. And ultimately, as we embrace this thing called storytelling, and the world of digital and how much it's changed. And for the Irish market, that had quite a significant impact on how we've structured our team, our agencies, and ultimately what we do in terms of briefs. So I'm going to take you through a little bit of that journey over the next kind of 20, 25 minutes. I probably don't need to give too much of an introduction into the brand. Hopefully you're all very familiar with it. The Heineken company globally is the world's most international brewer with over 200 beers. It's pretty much available in every country on the planet, and with the largest global brand within the portfolio being the Heineken brand itself, which I'm very lucky to work on. So it's our number one within the Irish portfolio, and actually within Ireland itself, it's the number one lager brand, with around 400,000 pints of it a day being drank, and in the on-trade, we've 40% market share. And actually, as of this month alone, we've overtaken, and we're number one in the off-trade as well. Lager for the first time, so we're celebrating that significant success for us as a team. So number one on and off trade. If you take total beer into account, we're number two in the on-trade to Guinness, which is what I've got my eye on in terms of trying to eat into their share. And we beat Guinness in the off-trade, so lots happening in both channels, which is very exciting for us as a brand. So what has made us so successful? I'm not going to dwell on this. I'm going to go pretty much into our digital piece. But ultimately, you know, it really is that kind of mix of from the liquid itself. It's been unchanged and, you know, superior quality of the liquid. Lots of innovation in terms of what we do, both in the channels with our product, with our SKU formats, packaging, you name it. Extra cold for us has been a significant success in the market over the last couple of years to drive us in growth. Distribution, price, our advertising, you'll be familiar with globally and Irish advertising over the years. We would be quite renowned for hopefully making good ads, some good, some bad. We can debate that afterwards. And our sponsorship platforms. I've just come back from Cardiff. We had our Heineken Cup final there on Saturday, which is a significant platform for us in the Irish market. So rugby, music, and Champions League being the three that we in Ireland would spend majority of our sponsorship funding and time behind. And how we kind of divvy that up from a brand perspective, I suppose our ultimate ambition is all around being the iconic brand. You know, when you think about a Guinness brand and the iconicity of that, and, you know, we would feel that we can certainly emulate that and other iconic brands that you can all have and think of in your head at the moment. We have three pillars that kind of, I suppose, support that, or how we'd look at kind of supporting our ambition. We call that our Man of the World pillar, which is essentially our TV advertising, big global campaign type advertising that you would see that are quite kind of sit outside of sponsorships. So that's our Man of the World pillar. That's who we call our target consumer. We have our world-class experiences, which is ultimately those three sponsorships. So we would have a significant investment behind what we call world-class experiences in Ireland and globally. And then we have a brand of the world pillar, which is all around our product and how we talk about our product. And from a marketing perspective, what we put up on outdoor, beautiful pint shots, product shots, what we talk about in outlet, across in the bar, when the barman is handing you a pint, all of that piece kind of falls in under the significant piece of the product and the brand. And the role of digital, and this isn't one I've just written for tonight, essentially has always, and certainly in the last year, from a global perspective and a strategy, and in Irish terms, it sits across all three. It doesn't sit in a pillar in itself. We know that it has to be crucially a part of those three pillars, and at the heart of those three pillars now. It can't sit kind of in isolation on your brief, on your media plan anymore, and I'll go into how we're embedding it. So it really is, you know, sitting across all of those three. And then, you know, ultimately then everything else kind of sits at the foundation. So let's go straight into digital. I'm not going to linger really on the brand, but I'm more than happy to talk afterwards to anyone who'd like to hear more on what we do around some of those pillars. And between the three of us, we all have a number of different slides in terms of digital landscape, and there's so much data that we have. And, you know, I suppose I'm in a lovely privileged position that we as Heineken and, you know, with our other guest speakers tonight, we have the budgets to have a significant amount of research, and sometimes it's death by statistic, and we maybe know far too much. We spend a lot of time analysing all of this. So there was an awful lot I could have pulled out. For the time, I pulled out a couple of slides, but ultimately, you know, this slide just shows a significant growth in terms of kind of media consumption and where that's coming from. And again, it just highlights that importance of digital, and consumers are spending their time kind of connected and connecting online. And this is kind of the average time spent. And really, you know, you can just see why wouldn't we as a company and as a brand be looking to put our money and our investment and our resources behind digital, because it, you know, just makes complete sense. In terms of time spent online, if you look at versus kind of 2009, again, you know, real growth. There's lots of different statistics on this. I've just pulled out one, but certainly indicatively as a trend, we all know we are spending so much more time online wherever we are. So again, you know, we need to be at the heart of that. Organic reach is declining. This is quite a... It's one that, you know, my team, we're spending an awful lot of time debating and wondering, I suppose, are Twitter going to follow? And you know, ultimately, from an organic reach perspective, if you look at just those two simple stats alone, you know, it's significantly reduced in terms of what organic reach you can get, let's say, on Facebook. So it's becoming increasingly harder, I suppose, you know, for our ability to get earned media. So that's a challenge, you know, and I don't want to spend my entire time pumping money into Facebook. So we need to look at, you know, in order to get the reach. So it really is in terms of, you know, building our own owned assets. What can we do to save us having to kind of constantly be pushing down that route for what has proven to be significantly less and less over time in terms of organic reach? And we know that ultimately, you know, this proliferation of what our consumers are on, you know, and we again, you know, 1 week our media agency would present, oh, you need to be on Snapchat, or you need to be on, you know, so Instagram at the moment, TunePix is one that they're talking to us on at the moment. You know, we all know about WhatsApp. There's a whole plethora of other things within there. And, you know, the careful choices that we need to make as to where, albeit we have good budgets, but we're not all made of money, and we can't start going down throwing money into pieces because it's the next best thing. So it's these kind of weighing up of careful decisions around where do we put our money. And globally, Heineken globally have kind of picked a couple of key partnerships that we can focus on, and we focus on then within OpCo. And you know, I think that's probably a watch out, which is, yeah, something might be absolutely key today, this month, but just with the whole changing environment, you know, who knows what's going to be the case tomorrow. And it used to be simple. It all, as a marketeer, and I'm, you know, doing it a long time at this stage, like, really, briefs used to be pretty simple. Brand communication to your audience, how you got them, was, you know, a TV ad, a press ad, it all was pretty simple. But we know our consumer and ultimately our audience are an entirely different audience to what they were a number of years ago. And they are, you know, absolutely empowered from being passive to really, you know, ultimately they're sitting watching television with your phone in your hand, the iPad, the iPhone. there's a dialogue, they want to interact, they want to hear more through all these different channels, and really the power is in their hands, and we'd be incredibly foolish to not recognise that. And, you know, ultimately, actually, our brands are really no longer our own, and we no longer really control our brands, because that's what the audience do now. So the conversation, the dialogues will happen about your brand and will be visible to far more people as they live online. So ultimately, you know, you have to embrace that, and you can't, there's an element of control, but you do have to embrace the fact that that is the landscape that we now work in. And as I say, they see themselves as part of the conversation. Our consumers would feel like they own the brand, that they are certainly a part of the brand. And that brings with it a lovely element of, you know, from an equity point of view, that there's that adoration of your brand, that people want to get involved and that they want to talk about you, that they want to be part of it. So we want to encourage that, but it brings its pitfalls. But ultimately, you have to recognize that as a brand. As I say, there really is a risk if you don't respond to that, and ultimately if you don't recognise that we have an empowered audience in our consumers and in our audience. So how have we, I suppose, changed then over the last period of time on Heineken and in Heineken in Ireland? I suppose, you know, as I said at the beginning, we would be kind of classically known as a big TV advertiser, as a big world-class kind of advertising. We would have over the years, either from an Irish perspective, created kind of tailored ads for this market. We did one last year for, let's say, the Heineken Cup. And then we kind of get these big global TV campaigns coming from, let's say, from Amsterdam. And that's really what we've been known for over the years, which brings certain issues as you try and then move to this new way of thinking, this new world. But, you know, ultimately, we have to be more than just good TV ads and better than just great advertisers. And it's all around, you know, for me, it's all around how do you get your consumers to feel that closeness and that love of a global brand. And for me in Ireland, I mean, it's a Dutch brand, it's an international brand. Some of what might be coming out of Amsterdam for me wouldn't necessarily be relevant to the Irish audience. So the task for our agencies and for my team is how do you get Irish consumers to feel close to what isn't, for example, an Irish brand, or isn't, you know, is a brand that is a little bit intangible because it's this global man of the world type thinking and these big brand ads that come down from global. So how do we make that relevant to Ireland, and how do we make that engaging for an Irish consumer? So ultimately, this is where I suppose the storytelling process has been kind of defined for us over the last year, and that we work very hard with our media agency Starcom and kind of the central media agency. And we talk about connection moments, and they've become incredibly important to us. And ultimately, how it's kind of defined is, you know, real moments within your target audience, real life, where they're most receptive to engaging with you. And the amount of detail and work that we go into before any brief on what we call these connection moments has proven to be definitely one of our success factors over the last year when I come to show you some of the content that we've created. So this isn't just about, we know that our 25 to 34 year old likes to read the Metro when he's on his way on the Lewis. And this isn't about, you know, okay, he likes to check his phone whilst watching TV. It's very in-depth detail of literally from the second he wakes up in the morning and presses his snooze button to the second he presses his light and goes to sleep at night. I'm talking about him because it's our core target audience, but it, male, females, it's whatever audience you're going after. It is a true in-depth understanding of their day and separated weekdays, weekends, who they're with, what they're doing on their lunch break, what they're engaging with, and ultimately knowing when is the moment that for that brief you can connect best and most efficiently. Because there could be 20 connection moments in the day. There's lots of times that you pick up your phone, you'll quickly check Facebook, or you'll quickly see something, or you'll scan a newspaper. But what we try to get to before we write the brief is what is, for that specific brief, so if it's music, when is that target consumer, and if our music brief is targeting 18 to 24-year-olds, so we'll narrow it right down, then where and who are we targeting, and at what time of day, what are they doing, what are they reading, what are they consuming, what are they talking about, And starting with that and that defining that connection moment for our agencies starts to distill down then straight away before you get into the brief. So getting the right connection moments and the deep understanding of your target consumer's behavior along with your media consumption habits is where we start, and that has proven very successful to us. And then we talk about telling them a story and this kind of element of storytelling. So what has changed for us over the years and for me as a marketeer is ultimately that we're asking our agencies for a story and for an idea. And I will kind of do the elevator test, which is when I'm back in tissue meetings, well, tell me the story. In a couple of lines, just tell me the story. And the brief, so we no longer write a brief for TV or a brief for a digital ad or whatever the format might be. We write a brief for an idea. And it's channel neutral. So there are no channel specific briefs anymore. We've restructured our agencies in the last year, so we no longer have a specific digital agency. So our comms agency is our through-the-line agency. It's great. They had that capacity. They are getting up to speed with digital. But it's because an idea, there's no point in having four, five, six agencies around the table to come up with an idea. One agency can come up with that idea. They don't have to be a specialist in that kind of media. And then you get your specialist involved. So when you understand what's your idea, where you want to tell it, where you want to place it, then you can get your agencies involved. And it saves us a lot on fees because you don't have six different agencies around the table all working towards the same brief. So we've cut all of that out and we brief one agency, land the idea, and we'll pick the agency that's most relevant to what we believe the idea will ultimately, what channel it'll go down in terms of, is it music or rugby or a Champions League. So we start with the idea, land the idea, simple, easy, can tell it in a couple of sentences. Then you get into your creative. So then you say, right, so now where does this lend itself best to be told? And that's when you get into your media agency and the telling part. So that's into ultimately then what are the right media formats and when is the right time to flight it, to air it, whatever it might be. And that's been incredibly powerful for us, that whole storytelling piece. And Heineken, you know, that word storytelling is literally a course within our global university in Amsterdam, and one that is rolled out and all agencies go through a full day or two course on this principle of storytelling, and all markets are looking at embedding that principle. And ultimately, it's moving from the brand being at the center of the brief and of your world to your audience being at the center of your world, and to recognize that the audience is the most important thing, ultimately, for your brand success. And these are kind of some of the characteristics, just pulling out some. So shifting from brand at the center, being compelling in a human, social, emotional way, contagious content that travels. We could talk about viral content all night. A blend of paid, owned, and earned. And again, we are lucky enough to have the budgets that we can pay to kick things off. And then, but you want the type of media and you want the type of content that will then take off for you and ultimately own, you know, get you that earned media. And I'll talk about owned in a moment. That ultimately triggers participation. And how we talk about it is fireworks and bonfires. It's nice and simple. So ultimately what we talk about is igniting the conversation with paid media. So we talk about our fireworks. So you light the firework with your content, and that's what basically reaches high and bright for everyone to see. And earned media is triggered by your firework, and it encourages your wider group to participate and share in your story. And then your bonfires build up the intensity over time, and how that's kind of depicted, I suppose, on a graph, very simply, is that. So really, we talk about the whole kind of piece of basically you start to generate your audience participation by lighting your fireworks so that you're not putting all of your money, all of the time kind of behind like big kind of paid media, but that you light it enough at the start to start the conversation, get the contact going. And I'll show you an example of how we've just done that in this market. And you keep it ticking over with your bonfire and you spark it again. And that's kind of as simple as that, really, in terms of kind of trying to put it on one side for you, and it's working very well for us. So, as I say, a new way of briefing, concentrating on a world-class idea, forget about the channel. And that has been probably the biggest, and look, it's simple, and probably not telling you anything you don't know. But, you know, coming into like such a big brand with such a big budget a year and a half ago, none of this was something we were doing. So it's very simple to come and stop doing a TV brief. Because as marketeers, we all like to make ads and TV ads. And a lot of people come in and just want it to be on the CV. But ultimately, you know, that's no longer the case for brands. And plenty of us don't have the budgets for that either. So that's so digital, crucially, for those without big brand budgets for TV advertising, this is so key. So I thought I'd just show an example, I suppose, of how that's worked, real live example from an Irish perspective, what we've just done, and maybe you'll have seen some of this. So we're lucky enough, we get some of our assets from Amsterdam, and you know, or some we won't be happy with, and we'll make ourselves. But what happened here was, from a storytelling principle in Amsterdam, the Odyssey campaign ultimately was launched. And as I say, they started with the idea. And the idea behind this campaign was that our men of the world, our target audience, globally and in Ireland, are actors of their lives and they're not spectators. The route that they went was a TV ad. So globally, it was a TV ad along with digital assets. And I'm going to just show you those, and then I'll show you how we ultimately then, from an Irish perspective, going through storytelling and connection moments, what we then created. So just show you the ad in case you haven't already seen it.
Bolei o ano inteiro este samba pra frente. É gostoso pá, que é um samba decente. Se ele é um barato e é da pesada. Fiz é o famoso 16 toneladas.
Chi è quell'uomo?
Tomiamo CBT, Jelan Chobek.
É o 16 toneladas.
So traditionally, I suppose, or even before I joined the brand, that's where it would have stopped as a global campaign. That would have been the ad. We would have aired the ad. We might have done a few banners. That would have been lovely. But actually, in fairness to global, and when I say global, sorry, I mean our central global communication team that are based out of Amsterdam that create some of the assets for the markets. They have recognized the need to move to digital, and they've recognized the need for viral content, and they recognize the need to entertain and to be a brand that's a little bit more witty and a little bit more fun. So they then, through storytelling, then have moved on to, from there, create this PR campaign that lived online.
Hello. I'm here to talk to you briefly on behalf of Heineken. We've noticed some people questioning the authenticity of our commercials. Like the King of Trolls. Birds don't take orders from anyone. And a rather unkind conspiracy Mike said, these guys are as fake as their beards. Well, conspiracy Mike, these guys are legendary at something. And to prove it, here are the casting tapes from our latest ad, so that you can see the guys as we did.
My name is Scott Sparrow. I'm a bird caller.
And what do you do?
Slide.
Cheers.
Cheers.
I think I bought one of the other markets editions of that, but anyway, so we could air that. So that started to become the kind of teaser early part of our seeding campaign. We would have gone live on TV with that and some of this. So then back to my earlier point, it's great you could leave it at that, and that's global content that maybe isn't as relevant to an Irish consumer. So we do what we call top spinning in this market, and Heineken, that's a term that we talk about a lot. So where markets take the core of an idea and they top spin it to make it relevant to their own consumer in their own market. So it becomes a top spin brief, a storytelling brief that is looking for top spin, that is looking to get the most out of that campaign for the Irish audience. So we write a top spin brief ultimately. And what we then look at is insights around, well, what's the inspiration globally, and this whole piece around everybody is legendary at something, which is the core of the idea. And then looking at it for an Irish audience, and really, won't be any surprise to us all, Irish people don't naturally like to seek the attention or to be seen really as up themselves. Probably a bit more of an English thing, maybe, coming from London. But so taking that insight, we kind of wanted to turn it on its head a little bit. So then we kind of looked at, okay, so on our website, we wanted people to sign up, that everybody, still taking that global line, everybody is legendary at something, sign up with your talent for a chance to win. So we kind of had our online hub. And then we created this.
Just find your mark and then introduce yourself.
Conor McGregor, mixed martial artist.
Jennifer McGuire, broadcaster.
Shane Byrne, former rugby international.
Thank you. You can start warming up now.
GH Samba Kings, que é muito legal. É super pra frente, é bem genial. Embalo como este, só quem vai curtir. Quem não se machucar quando deixa cair. Por isso vem, vem, quem parou na nossa. Este balanço
ready?
Tira qualquer um da moça. Ele é barato e é da pesada. Este é o famoso 16 toneladas. Bolei o ano inteiro este samba pra frente. É gostoso o parque, é samba decente.
Did you do anything else?
Quem não gosta de samba não gosta de nada. E agora...
So you see there that we're asking people to upload their talent.
Okay.
Pretty good. It's beautiful. So really, this was where I suppose we now start getting into looking at people creating their content for us, giving us the content. So it's the fireworks and the banners. So you have your global campaign. Then we created a hub for people to upload their own piece. And then you spark the conversation with ultimately recruiting, in our case, kind of local ambassadors, local celebrities, to kind of get that going and look to recruit people to start creating their own content and to be in with a chance to win. We then we did a partnership with YouTube. And we had quite an extensive online partnership, I suppose. And again, taking kind of some of the elements for the ad and just getting people to kind of engage with us and enticing them to then come and show us their legendary skill as we go through. And this banner ad actually was featured this week in the Google Global Banner Gallery, I was told to let people know, and which is seemingly, which is wonderful news for us and our team. And particularly given we have a new agency in the door, it's lovely to see them getting featured there. So then we kind of moved on from there, and ultimately then all of that then really for us was also around driving PR, driving engagement, driving the content, getting content that we can use online in order to do what we then did to kind of round off the campaign.
Mr. Spoon.
I am the legendary escapologist.
I am the legendary Iceman.
I am the legendary Keepy Upper.
Look. He's great.
Samba quente, que é muito legal. É super pra frente, é bem genial. Embalo como este, só quem vai curtir. Quem não se machucar quando deixa cair. Por isso vem, vem, quem parou na nossa. Este balanço tira qualquer um da fossa. Ele é um barato e é da pesada. Este é o famoso 16 toneladas. E... já dei o meu recado, agora vou me mandar. Vou refrescar a cuca pra poder incrementar. Hoje cuca cansada, só dá confusão. Onda de pirado deixa a gente sonelar.
So that
wasn't expecting that.
Wasn't expecting that at all.
Thanks for not telling me anything at all.
The audience were just insane.
Actually, I don't even know what happened the last 30 minutes or whatever it was.
So that's been very successful for us. It's literally just kind of come off air, and ultimately the results have been very strong. There we are. So all our key brand metrics have increased. And the local celebrities and Irish execution ultimately brought the brand closer to our target audience. And that's kind of what I was talking about, really, in terms of the fireworks and the bonfires and taking what was a global idea and then localising it and really making it relevant to your audience here. We've got great success in terms of combined views, most shared video in Ireland that period. And ultimately, the digital campaign has delivered for us 3 times the industry average on click-through rates. So we're really, really happy with that. And then ultimately we were looking at, so that's our kind of big Legends campaign. And, you know, similarly then we had the issue with, so we've Heineken Cup. And so take, for example, kind of a very quick turnaround brief where ultimately when an Irish team unfortunately didn't get into the final, we were left in a position, it's a very big pillar for us, but actually how do you get people talking about it over the kind of couple of weeks in the run-up to the final when actually there wasn't a huge amount of Irish relevance for that kind of past kind of couple of weeks just running up to Saturday. So it was a very, very quick brief that we gave, and actually relatively cheap in the scheme of things. And we created this, which has been and this is our last, my last video of the day, and I'm nearly finished. So this was our most recent piece. If we can play the next video.
Not long now to the big Heineken Cup final in Cardiff. I'm on the streets of Dublin just gauging the interest and the expectations and talking to some experts who know the game.
Excuse me. Sorry, do you have a minute? We're doing a report with Brent Pope.
You're a saviour, thanks very much.
We just had a cancellation last minute. The Italian guy that was meant to come over, he's way late at the airport,
okay.
So...
you're meant to be effectively French. It's just a case, really, of standing in there. Yeah. I'll do the rest. They're just going to ask me a couple of questions. You'll be grand.
You're kind of looking...
you're to look Welsh, if you can.
Okay.
Everyone is just a light feet, so I mean, they're probably not even going to come to you.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1...
Over live to Dublin now, where we have Brent Pope. How are things in Dublin? You know, it's a rugby city and there's a lot of interest around the game. Who will prevail, Saracens or Toulon? You have somebody with you. Yes, we have Jean-Claude Baptiste. Of course, Jean-Claude, well known for his, I suppose, views in French rugby. Bonjour, Jean-Claude.
Bonjour, comment ça va?
Hello, Christian.
Hello, how are you doing?
Martin, hello.
Hi.
Is that a Nice accent?
People like to refer me to a French hipster.
Who are the key players?
Johnny Wilkinson is
Johnny Wilkinson, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a great kicker, and if it turns out to be a kicking game, he'll do it for them.
Well, I mean, I don't know, maybe you're more in listen to...
Well, obviously, we talked before, you know, John Court doesn't want to give too much away.
We have to go to a commercial break now.
Guys, we're going to take a two-minute break.
Two-minute break, OK. Just time to go.
Yeah, literally just...
2 seconds.
Yeah.
Brent, is Brent back? Brent? Anybody seen Brent? Eyes on Brent. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hello, is that Brent?
That's
Jean-Claude, is that you?
Oui. Somewhere.
Brent, he'll be with us in a moment. We're just waiting for him now.
Brent is not here at the moment, but I'm going to wrap this up.
Just allez Toulon, do us proud, and get 2 in a row.
Thank you for watching, and enjoy the Heineken Cup.
From Ireland and from Dublin here, we say goodbye.
And we're out.
It's a wind-up.
It is cool.
Oh, amazing.
It's a wind-up.
When you went to the toilet, it's only like he's absolutely winding me up.
He's shaking.
I've never known a man to bluff so well.
So that has just been up, I think, around 2 weeks, and for very, very little budget in, I suppose, our scheme of things, has been hugely successful. So no TV required, literally just with no Irish team in the final, how do we use digital and a viral asset to get talked about and to get PR? And actually that has been incredibly successful for us. And, you know, at the end, we're ultimately linking people through to our app and our Get in the Game app and rugby and getting more plays. And you know, again, that's been hugely successful in driving people to our app to engage with us even further for longer periods of time. I'm over time, so I'm going to speak very fast now. So literally, in summary, importance of digital, really don't look at it in isolation, and ultimately allows you to get closer to your consumer if it's used right. It's naturally going as part of our media spend, and it allows us express our personality and ultimately to tell those stories that I've talked about better. I was asked to kind of quickly talk about what hasn't worked so well for us. I could probably go on all night. We make a lot of mistakes. We do a lot of things wrong. So I'm sure there's lots that you look at from Heineken and think, questionable, to say the least. But however, using social media as an advertising platform, we certainly learned that really that's not working. It's not working for us. And, you know, a lot of brands are still talking about consumers through social media, just like it's another advertising medium. We have to move away from that. And then, you know, another example would be our current owned platforms or a music platform. What frustrated the hell out of me for the last year is that we were trying to sell tickets on our .com music website. That's what Ticketmaster does. Why would we bother? There's no need. But at the same time, why would people come to us to hear about a band? They can go to the band website. So music is a really tricky one, actually, as we try and get that right. And that's still really where we're working through a music strategy at the moment, and the role that content can play and owned piece is a really, really big question for us as to really why do people want to come to you versus us being where they are, and that's the most important thing. Tips for you to take away: understand when it's best to talk to your consumers, the connection moment that I talked about, leverage advocates. Okay, we were lucky enough to have 3 Irish celebrities, relatively low cost, but at the same time, from your perspective, you know, what are the advocates in your world that you can kind of have to talk and to allow your content to travel and get those bonfires going? You know, being clever around your production costs, there's no point in paying a significant amount of production if no one's going to see it, and understanding what you're competing against ultimately from a global production and global budgets point of view. And I think that's me, and sorry for rattling through the end, and thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Judy. I'm delighted that you mentioned the bit about, at the very beginning, that the idea is more important than the medium. You start with the idea. Now, I don't think there's anybody from a media independent here tonight, is there? So I can be really rude, because they're inclined to say that the medium is the most important thing. It's not, it's the idea. And it's nice to hear that reiterated. I'm sure you'll all be able to copy some of the ideas you've heard there. I'm going to copy the one about jigsaws and bonfires. I can certainly use that when I'm lecturing. People who lecture in business colleges are far more shameless than any agency in taking an idea from somebody else and saying it was their own. So I have no hesitation in doing that. Our second speaker is from Mondelez, which I have to confess I'm not all that familiar with, but I would say Cadbury's is one of the most familiar brand names that I would be aware of in Ireland. I grew up with Cadbury's. Shane Guest is a senior brand manager for chocolate with over 10 years experience across the whole of the Cadbury range. And he's going to talk about the tipping point for digital media in his company. Shane.
Good evening, everybody. You'll have to excuse me, I'm suffering from a bit of a chest infection, so I might be inclined to have a tickly throat or cough at some point in time. So, I'm the piece of chocolate between a pint of Heineken and a can of Diet Coke. So hopefully this goes down nice and sweet. I guess, to John's point, Mondelez International, who are we? Our brand mantra is all about creating delicious moments of joy, and that's something that we endeavour to do, be it with our consumers, our colleagues, our communities, or even our customers. We're a relatively new business, a new startup. I think our chairman or chairwoman coined the phrase that we were the biggest ever startup when the announcement of Mondelez International came about. And it came about as a result of, I guess, a marriage or the acquisition of Kraft Foods when they acquired Cadbury. It created a business with a market cap of just under $55 billion. And after about a year or so of trading, they decided to split the company in two, focusing one company on, which was the Kraft North America company, on the high-margin, low-growth business, and then Mondelez International becoming the business which was a global snacks business, which is very much high growth, but challenged margins, should we say. And I guess more recently, it was only announced last week, the decision to split our coffee business away from Mondelez and create a joint venture with Douwe Egberts. And that new business will be known as Jacob Douwe Egberts, which will come into, come into creation the middle of next year. So there's a lot of work behind the scenes being done on that. And as a result, then, an awful lot of work being done on ensuring that Mondelez remains a very much a pure play snacking business. So I was keen to give you a bit of an insight into who Mondelez were, that we're not just a chocolate business. Although, I guess, from an Irish perspective, while there are five categories within the business, chocolate dominates within that, given the presence of Cadbury in the marketplace here. And within Ireland, the chocolate category itself represents about 80% of the total Mondelez Irish business, then made up of biscuits, coffee, gum and candy, and beverages as well. And I guess you'll recognize some of the brands here, and maybe some less so. Following the acquisition of Cadbury by Kraft, there's been some significant NPD has been launched. And I guess that's one of the biggest opportunities for myself anyway as a marketeer to see that pipeline coming through now. So you'll probably recognize on your shop shelves the likes of CDM and Oreo, equally with Philadelphia and Cadbury Chocolate coming together as well, which is quite an interesting piece of NPD. Not too sure about its ongoing success though. And equally we've launched Cadbury Dairy Milk Egg and Spoon, which fundamentally came from the Milka brand, whereby you know the Milka team in the DACH region in Austria and Germany had launched Milka Egg and Spoon, and thereby we were able to lift and drop that under the Cadbury Dairy Milk brand in the UK and Irish market. So there's been some, real benefit as a result of the Kraft acquisition of Cadbury as a result. And just finally, a little bit on Mondelez in Ireland. I'm based in Coolock. It's one of the three offices or three sites throughout the country. We also have a site in Rathmore and also in Talla. Rathmore plant focuses on making chocolate crumb, which is effectively, in bread-making parlance, it's the dough that makes bread, and Crumb makes chocolate. And then Tala produce gum base, which effectively 100% of it is exported to meet the needs of our chewing gum brands across mainland Europe. And I guess most excitingly, the brands that we produce here in Ireland, you know, we produce Twirl, Time Out and Snack, Flake, Morrow and Starbar, all in Coolock. And more importantly, we produce the jewel in our crown, which is Cadbury Dairy Milk 8 Square, been produced in Ireland since 1933, and a brand that we're immensely proud of as well. I guess one of the things as well, from a manufacturing viewpoint, the benefit of the Kraft acquisition has brought is that it's opened new markets to us as well. So we've recently launched Starbar in Sweden, so we're now producing Starbar for the Swedish market there under the Marabou brand. And more recently, Twirl has made its way across the Atlantic to Argentina. So we're now producing in Coolock for the Argentinian market. So Argentinian consumers are beginning to experience Twirl for the first time. So all very exciting stuff from a manufacturing point of view. And I guess since the acquisition, things have been very, very much very, very busy, I guess, overall. So on to digital and all things digital at Mondelez. And I guess it really fundamentally is a story of scale and learning. And we are continuously being recognized for our leading class, our leading execution of digital expertise, from partnering with global technology companies to indeed working with tech startups to find that next big thing. So I just wanted to briefly touch on some of the digital trends impacting marketeers at the moment. Moving on then to some of the, I guess, the global views of how Mondelez looks at digital, and particularly in mobile in particular. And then I'll culminate showing you some of the case studies that we've worked on in it from an Irish perspective, and particularly across the dairy milk brand itself. So just touching on some of the global trends shaping marketing today, and Julie in some respects has touched on quite a lot of this as well, but you know, there's a continuous growth of the digital connections. We're now able to open our gates to our house, if we're lucky enough to have gates in our house, with a touch of a, just ringing a mobile number. The pervasive global mobile usage is just ongoing, and I think there's so much more of a focus becoming on mobile now. It's just going to be immense. And I guess, particularly for FMCG companies, there's a huge opportunity ahead of us to win at impulse. I don't think we're even there yet in it from an Irish market point of view, in fact, even maybe not from a global perspective, but how we can actually win at impulse, be it at reminding people at point of purchase, or indeed being able to enable people to transact and use and acquire our brand at that point of purchase. Obviously, the rise of e-commerce is something that retailers are focusing their attention on more and more, and it's something that as brands we need to ensure that we are best placed to be able to capitalize on that as well. And equally, the disruptive power of social networks. Julie spoke earlier about two or three screens on the go at the one time, and the whole plethora of social media that's out there now and catching people's attention. So knowing and understanding when is best to be in that space for your brand is critical. And obviously the high-speed connectivity of all screens, and as bandwidth grows, as broadband speeds up as well, it's there's a huge amount of opportunity ahead for us. But all of this means that it's quite a challenge for us as marketeers to strike the right note with our target audience in such a fast-changing environment. I guess, not only should marketeers be nervous, but almost dentists should be as well. Apparently, mobile has greater presence in global culture than hygiene does. There's 7 billion people on Earth, 5.1 billion own a mobile phone, and 4.2 billion only claim to own a toothbrush. So I guess the other 900 million didn't get the text message. But the fact is, I guess, if the internet was a wave, that mobile is a real tsunami, and the pace at which the waves are crashing on our shores are unprecedented. And when you look at a simple stat such as how long it takes media to hit 50 million consumers, you've probably all seen this in some form or another, 38 years for radio to reach 50 million consumers, 13 years for TV, 4 years for the internet, and 2 years for iPhone. So the impact on society and at this scale is just unprecedented. And it's impacting on our daily behavior. Texting has become like blinking. The average person sends about 4,000 texts per month. The average teenager sends multiple times more than that. And texting can actually get you closer to God, if not at least a €1,000 fine if you're stuck in the car here. It's becoming more and more pervasive. And I guess globally, from a Mondelez perspective, we've been very public in our commitment to mobile, and it's very much about getting to 10. And, you know, for us, we have aspirations around, it's not just about having aspirations, it's about having the right allocations. So leading with our largest brands, we're pushing towards investing 10% of global marketing budgets in mobile activations and channels across the entire consumer journey. So shifting this much to mobile will take time. It's a huge effort, but as a business, we're committed to winning in this space. And I guess how we're going to do that is that we've taken an investment strategy around four key areas. One around increasing media return on investment, and secondly around influencing purchase through video, focusing on video equivalency. So it's not just about TV, but it's about understanding the pervasiveness of all screens, be it linear TV, mobile, etc. And equally the social aspect of TV then as well, and how that's linking, how mobile is linking in with that. Mobile as a media in its own right, looking at it as a pure media platform, we've seen engagement rates and click-through rates 2 or 3 or even 4 times greater than traditional display. So it's really key that we're playing in that space. And then obviously mobile at retail, a constantly evolving area that we need to have success in, and something that we're making strides in. So I guess our commitment to mobility is actually a commitment to real-time marketing. And you've probably all seen this, and our global team on Oreo are quite proud of the fact of what this has done. But everybody talks about the Super Bowl tweet, and the brand team worked very closely with their agency partners in a war room during the Super Bowl. And when the lights went out, they were best placed to capitalize on the moment and came up with the tweet, "Power out, no problem, you can still dunk in the dark." And that got overwhelming buzz and reaction. You can see the stats on the right-hand side. But it showed the scale of engagement and real-time marketing that can be delivered in the right moment. And I guess what people recognize less so is that we had, or the global brand team had built that muscle memory long before this ever came to hitting people's mobile screens or desktops. But it was really about being in the right place at the right time, but knowing how to react to it. And that was brought about, that muscle memory was built up through the daily twist. So for Oreo's 100th birthday, long before the Super Bowl ever happened, they had a strategy around taking real-time publishing to a new level. So every day for 100 days, they delivered a fresh twist or an advertisement that reflected in real time what was going on in global culture. And the creative was inspired from everything, with the likes of Gay Pride, as you see here, to the Mars landing or to the London 2012 Olympics. And you'll see some other creatives there that were used throughout the 100 days of the Great Twist campaign. So, focusing a little bit more on home and closer to home, in September 2012, the global comms platform for Cadbury Dairy Milk was launched, entitled Joyville. And our task as a local brand team here was to bring that to life in Ireland. And I just wanted to share with you how we did that, particularly from a digital context. And I guess on the basis that we had created this brand platform, Joyville was this mythical place where Cadbury Dairy Milk is made, and that intrudes into real-life world in random magical instances. So that was our challenge and how we could bring that to life. The difficult thing about it is, how do you explain it to, first of all, your sales team, and then how do you try and explain it to your consumers? So ultimately, it was about trying to get people on board first. And the solution for us was very much about ignoring the cynics and focusing on who are we actually targeting here. So it was very much about targeting the Harry Potter generation, those people who believed in a mythical place, who believed in that the magic does happen from time to time. But equally, he was focusing on the choctimists, those glass half full people within us all. So that's where our media attention lay. And we use non-traditional media as a gateway to a parallel world in order to bring Joyville to life. And this video will show you just how that was achieved.
Joyville is a legend, told by a man with a big heart and a very sweet tooth. It's not a place or Willy Wonka's chocolate factory. It's a parallel universe that exists everywhere around us, if you look hard enough. Our mission was to invite people into the magical world of Joyville to experience delicious Cadbury chocolate and so multiply the joy in Ireland. Just as we believe platform 9 3/4 is the only way to get into Hogwarts, or a rabbit hole is the only way to get into Alice's Wonderland, our strategy was to use media as a sliding door moment, taking consumers for a few seconds into Joyville's magical and chocolatey reality. On Ireland's leading property website, we offered a piece of Joyville real estate, putting a magical house up for sale, complete with chocolate billiard table, mantelpiece, and cupboards stocked with Cadbury Dairy Milk chocolate, with interested parties able to interact with a real-life Joyville property consultant. In shopping malls, we created an interactive experience using Xbox Kinect technology, inviting people to immerse themselves inside the world of Joyville. On radio, we narrated the story of Joyville as a bedtime fairy tale, capturing the imaginations of children and adults alike. At point of sale, we continued to exemplify this alternative universe, creating a storybook environment in a unique and innovative way. And we brought the magic of Joyville to life with real-world, out-of-home encounters, amplifying the whole experience online and in social media. The campaign sprinkled pure magic, driving sales a joyful 7%, capturing the imagination with almost half of people believing in the magic of Joyville, and almost 3/4 feeling Joyville persuaded them to buy more Cadbury Dairy Milk chocolate. And thanks to Joyville, more consumers now believe Dairy Milk tastes better than ever, with the highest taste scores in over 5 years. And the story of Joyville has only just begun.
So that was Joyville, and I guess, and you saw the results that ensued from that. But I guess over the course of 5 or 6 months after that, we discovered that joy is not necessarily derived from the Joyvillian characters that inhabited the global campaigns, but that it actually resides in the reactions of people in much the same way as you saw with some of the Heineken stuff earlier, and how people actually engage in on a real personal level and how that does. So we focus our attention very much on bringing brand love in a very much a surprise and delight way. One of the offshoots of that was that we were able to share the joy with 12.5 million people in 3 days. And what we did was we created the joy tree. And the creative insight, joy can't be prescribed to people. People need to actually experience joy themselves. So that creative insight informed our idea for Joy Tree, which was a real-life portal into a parallel world, unexpectedly located in St. Anne's Park in Raheny. The Joy Tree was a chocolate-giving tree that surprised and delighted passers-by. So rather than the traditional approach of producing an ad using actors, we used real people, real Irish locations, real alpacas with unicorns, and real reactions to Cadbury chocolate. And the magic of randomly encountering a chocolate tree in a suburban Dublin park, for us, replicated the joy of eating Cadbury Dairy Milk chocolate. So we put 10 cameras in place, hid in the bushes, and crossed our fingers and toes. And this is what happened. Run that again. There we go. So that was Joy Tree. So I guess, and you find a lot of similarities between what I'm saying, what Julie has just said, and possibly what Carlan will say. When it came to seeding Joy Tree, we took a very structured approach around, enabling people to discover it. So, we were clear on having an idea that was designed to be discovered and shared, that it would enable organic, authentic word of mouth to be created. And we invited specific people to get involved in discovering it. And that was really much around creating as much earned media as possible. The second step was about encouraging as much engagement as possible. So we let the official brand voice speak for itself and of the idea, revealing it to our followers, fans, and friends via our social media touchpoints. And that was very much about engaging with the earned and owned media and driving that. And then ultimately, we followed up then with a lot of paid media to generate a lot of reach. So, once we had that genuine word of mouth and engagement established, we generated reach through the amplification of paid media, so promoted posts, tweets, et cetera, et cetera. And we had our PR team and digital teams working hard in terms of achieving that. And we had a lot of news coverage, blog coverage, online competitions, radio competitions as well. And from a local perspective, we're lucky to have quite high profile fans of Cadbury and Cadbury Dairy Milk in Ireland, and we were able to engage with the likes of Ronan Keating and Niall Horan as we just launched Joy Tree and shared with them the wonder that was Joy Tree, and they ultimately then passed that on to their friends as well. So overnight, after a retweet from Niall Horan to his 11 million followers, it was just, it was stratospheric stuff. So it just showed, for us, it shows the power that digital can really bring to campaigns such as this. So I guess onto some of the more straightforward stuff in terms of the results. We saw a significant increase in brand tracking scores. Our brand linkage was up 23%, persuasion was up 20%, and uniqueness of the brand was up 18%. So all very positive in terms of delivering on the brand. The YouTube video in Ireland on the second day of media hit over 813 views, and global trending soon followed from the launch of paid media. So we were trending in Argentina, we were trending in Brazil, etc. Our Twitter followers for CDM increased 11-fold, and over 1,500 mentions of Share the Joy. And as I said, we had extensive media relations with online influencers such as Niall Horan, Ronan Keating, and even from a GA perspective, Bernard Brogan, all helping to spread the joy. And I guess the most telling piece was that for us as a business, we were quite rooted in very traditional approach to comms, and it was a real eye-opener for us in terms of the power of earned media for a business such as ourselves. So that was a real telling aspect that has now led us to take a very different approach to our comms planning going forward. More recently, I guess, and you'll probably see on all your shop shelves, the coveted Cadbury Dairy Milk foil and band is no longer with us. Having been produced in Coolock since 1933, we took the brave and bold decision to change out of foil and band into floor wrap packaging. And I just wanted to share with you the role that digital played in embedding that new pack change. It was a very contentious decision to make the packaging change, but I'm delighted to say that it's worked. It's worked on a number of areas. It's driven modernity in the brand. It's resealable, the packaging itself. And I guess from a pure business metrics point of view, it's improved our margins as well. So we're not double wrapping a product anymore. We're just single wrapping a product, which cuts down on time in the plant, etc. So as a result, from making that change in making the packaging change, we wanted to focus on a campaign that would try to reinvigorate people's appetite and desire towards the entire 8 variants that is Cadbury Dairy Milk. So Rate the 8 is based around a website where people rate their favorite CDM bars. And the video which I'm about to show you is a live demo of the website. And the starting point of the production was Facebook. So everyone in the video is a fan of Cadbury on Facebook. And we got them to come in and do a behind-the-scenes piece around picking their best or most preferred variant. And the video is done in a how-well-do-you-know-each-other type style quiz. And the output matches your choice against others who have taken that quiz. with a competition element giving daily prizes to two people who have the most similar taste buds. So we'll show you the video now and how that has worked for us. So that's been our biggest campaign of the year so far, and for a business such as ours, for your biggest campaign not to appear on TV was pretty much unprecedented in our business up to now. And we didn't air that ad on TV. We put a lot of paid media behind it, generating over 1 million views in 5 weeks. Where we did also put paid media was behind outdoor, and you would have seen it the length and breadth of the country. You know, posing that question, do you prefer a Tiffin over a Caramello or a Fruit and Nut over a Mint and Crisp? And obviously we brought it to life in store as well, giving people the chance to spin that wheel and choose their favorite. And I guess the results speak for themselves, because what we've seen is that in the first quarter of this year alone, we've seen double-digit value and volume growth in a market that is considerably challenged in terms of volume decline. So for the eight variants themselves to be growing at such a drastic rate is phenomenal, and we're hugely proud of that fact now. The interesting thing about it is the one that's growing the least is our core product, Cadbury Dairy Milk Pure. When we've got the likes of Mint Crisp and Tiffin growing at 28, 29% quarter one this year versus quarter one last year. So it's worked. It has actually helped to reinvigorate people's views of the range, and digital went a long way towards making that a reality. So just to close, in terms of digital tips and considerations, touching on what I explained around Oreo, real-time marketing success doesn't happen overnight. You need to develop the muscle memory, but you need to do it in a way that's relevant for your brand. Digital isn't the only element of the marketing mix. So, you know, it's a very, very increasingly important element of the mix, but can be copper-fastened by other areas of the marketing mix as well. And in much the same way as Heineken have explained to you, you know, to leverage brand advocates to deliver scale, and we saw that with the likes of Ronan Keating and Niall Horan, you know, being able to socialise what we did with Joytree. And very much focusing on storytelling, what that big idea is, because for us, Joytree was all about the genuine, joyful reactions of people and what that can bring and what that can mean to your brand and your campaign, and having the compelling content to drive off that. So I'll wrap up on that note now, and thank you very much for your time.